Hachette Audio presents Colonize This, Young Women of Color on Today's Feminism, New Edition. Edited by Daisy Hernández and Bushra Rehman. Read by Ariana Delawari, Sharmila Devar, Kyla Garcia, Almarie Guerra, Greta Jung, Staci Mitchell, and Kristyl Dawn Tift. Foreword. The Warpath of Greater Empowerment. CHERRÍE MORAGA. Colonize This is a collection of writings by young women of color that testifies to the movement, political and physical, of a new generation of global citizens, activists, and artists. It is a portrait of the changing landscape of U.S. women of color identity, one that guarantees no loyalties to the borders that attempt to contain it. As immigrant, native-born, and survivor of slavery daughters, these women are the female children of those refugees from a world on fire, described in the 1983 edition of This Bridge Called My Back. They are women who have come of age with the living memory of disappearance in Colombia and Argentina, and the daily reality of war, always a phone call away. They are young sisters, our daughters, who didn't grow up to be statistics, Taji Smith, who have read and been schooled by the feminist writings and works of the women of color who preceded them, and as such, are free to ask questions of feminism more deeply than we could have imagined 20 years ago. The feminism portrayed in Colonize This reflects what in the 1980s we understood as theory in the flesh, a strategy for women's liberation which is wrought from the living example of female labor and woman acts of loving. These narratives reflect consciousness born out of what their, our, mothers, knew firsthand, the interlocking system of racism, poverty, and sexism. Siobhan Brooks. In Colonize This, mothers serve as mirrors of choices made and unmade. They are the reflection of sacrifice, survival, and sabiduría. They are Cecilia Bailly's mother, who each evening wiped off the dining room table after dinner to double as a desk for her two daughters. They are she who had no more than 7 years of school buying encyclopedias from the grocery store on the installment plan. They are Anna from British Guyana, who used her sexiness to get things like money, kerosene to light the lamps, and food for her children. Paula Austin. They are Tanmeet Sethi's mother, who advised, "You have to make home wherever you are." And this is what she did, coming to the United States with a stranger who was her new husband. They are Siobhan Brooks's mother, who was once placed in a mental hospital for infanticide, and who, in spite of her mental state, paid the bills on time, shopped for food, and refused the free bread-and-butter services the government offered. They are models of resistance, from whom their daughters, through fierce loyalty to them, wield weapons of theory and practice. In Colonize This, editors Bushra Rehman and Daisy Hernández have created an expanded vocabulary to describe an expanded feminism profoundly altered by massive immigration to the United States from North Africa, South and West Asia, and Central and South America. An echoing theme in this collection is the impact of the U.S. experience in introducing the critical questions of inequalities in relation to gender. Similarly echoed is the profound disappointment in white feminist theory to truly respond to the specific cultural and class-constructed conditions of women of color lives. As Ijoma A. describes it, consciousness about sexism assumed language and impetus in the United States, but it was born in the kitchens of her native Nigeria. Colonize This draws a complex map of feminism, one that fights sexism and colonialism at once and recognizes genocide as a present and daily threat to our blood nations. The feminism articulated in this collection requires cultural tradition and invention, negotiating multiple worlds. It is a theory and freedom practice which allows women to retain their culture, to have pride in their traditions, and to still vocalize the gender issues of their community. Susan Muadi Daraj. As Tanmeet Sethi writes, she is happy to wear the weight of her culture. She speaks of the gold jewelry inherited from family, but more so she speaks of the profound preciousness of culture. It is heavy, but not a burden. As a new generation of women of color, these writers carry a new language to describe their passions, their política, their prayer, and their problems. In these narratives, Black feminism finds resonance in hip-hop. Racism is now called driving while Black and walking while brown, Pandora Leong, in the middle-class neighborhoods of Oregon. White male entitlement assumes a 21st-century look in blonde dreadlocked Indophiles studying Buddhism and getting down with the people. Bhavana Modi. Here, sexuality and pleasure are unabashedly integrated in a feminist of color analysis of survival and liberation, and queer familia is neither a question nor the subject of debate. Still, some things haven't changed. Stereotyping does not change, as Alaska-born Asian American Pandora Leong reminds us. I do not read Chinese or know anything about acupuncture. Women of color still suffer the same assaults against our bodies, the artillery of misogyny ever inventive. Patricia Justine Tumong testifies to the living nightmare of the RU486 abortion pill. And Stella Luna recounts her own struggle for self-reclamation as a mother with HIV, writing, I realized that I was imprisoned not only by a disease, but also by a culture that had trained me to be as clean and untouched in soul and body as the Virgen de Guadalupe. If I chose to live my life according to this structure, maybe I should just give up and die. This is the real work of women of color feminism: to resist acquiescence to fatality and guilt, to become warriors of conscience and action who resist death in all its myriad manifestations: poverty, cultural assimilation, child abuse, motherless mothering, gentrification, mental illness, welfare cuts, the prison system, racial profiling, immigrant and queer bashing, and invasion and imperialism at home and at war. To fight any kind of war, Kahente Horn Miller writes, quoting her elder, the biggest single requirement is fighting spirit. I thought much of this as I read Colonize This. Since this collection appears in print at a time of escalating worldwide war in Colombia, Afghanistan, Palestine. But is there ever a time of no war for women of color? Is there ever a time when our home, our body, our land of origin is not subject to violent occupation, violent invasion? If I retain any image to hold the heart intention of this book, it is found in what Horn Miller calls the necessity of the war dance. This book is one rite of passage, one ceremony of preparedness on the road to consciousness, on the war path of greater empowerment. May 14, 2002, Oakland, California.
Introduction to the second edition. Daisy Hernández. I became a feminist because of an index card. It was my junior year of college, and I found myself one afternoon in a room at the student center that had a very low ceiling and thin carpeting. I had shown up not because the event was organized by the feminist collective, but because it had been advertised as a workshop on sexuality. Being the daughter of Cuban and Colombian immigrants who had worked in factories, I thought of sex as taboo. Now here was the word on a flyer like an invitation. That is how I ended up sitting in a stiff chair in a circle of mostly white girls, all of us with index cards and pens in our hands. On one side of the card, we noted our best sexual encounters, and on the back, our worst. We were giddy, pensive, nervous. We glanced at each other, then at the cards. Some of us wrote too quickly. Others tapped the edges of the cards. I already knew my answers. I wrote swiftly. The moderator collected the cards and began reading aloud from them. They were anonymous, of course, and she read the good ones first. Multiple orgasms, the pleasures of receiving oral sex, hearing I love you after sex. I grinned like I knew what that was all about. But in reality, I'd only read about most of these sexual joys in Cosmo. Here, though, were real women, my age, confirming that sex could be good. Then the moderator flipped the index cards and began reading the other side. Out came short lines about the boyfriend who wouldn't take no for an answer, the friend who demanded sex, the family member who forced himself. We fell silent. I fell silent. I don't remember now whether I wrote about the family member who had molested me as a child, but I do remember thinking, it wasn't just us. Us was me and the girls I had known over the years who had also been abused. I had thought sexual violence only happened to me and my friends. I had thought it had to do with the way we looked, the length of our legs, our dark hair. Now here was a stack of index cards from girls I had never met before, and the index cards were telling me that my experiences as a Latina girl in one corner of Jersey belonged to a much larger story of violence against mujeres. Later, I learned that in the early 1970s, the writer Jane O'Reilly had called this the click. That moment when you realize that what happens to you because you're a woman is happening to other women too. A new awareness snaps into place. I was ready to call myself a feminist. There was only one problem. My father. When I was in my early 20s, academics were theorizing about the voice of the teenage girl, how it develops, and how she loses it. But for as long as I could remember, I had used my girl voice to speak for my Cuban father, who was only fluent in Spanish. I interpreted for him at the factory where he worked, and also at unemployment agencies and banks. It didn't matter whether I was 12 or 22. I was Papi's voice. At home, he terrorized me and the women in our family with his rage and alcohol abuse. But out in the world, he relied on me. Feminism for me had to address not only my experiences of gender, but also of race, multilingualism, citizenship, class, and diaspora. By the time I left college and was harboring crushes on women and gender nonconforming people, I realized that feminism had to also be about queerness. Was that a tall order? I didn't think so. It was my life, and the lives of the women I knew. After college, I discovered that Black feminists, Barbara Smith, for example, had been arguing since the 1970s that feminism had to tackle how Black women experience gender in combination with race and class. Smith and her feminist comadres penned this argument in the now famous Combahee River Collective Statement. And in 1980, Gloria Anzaldúa and CHERRÍE MORAGA published the anthology This Bridge Called My Back, bringing together women of color to talk about feminism, raza y más. In that book, CHERRÍE wrote exactly what I was thinking about two decades later. I want a movement that helps me make some sense of the trip from Watertown to Roxbury, from white to Black. I love women the entire way, beyond a doubt. I too needed a feminism that helped me make sense of the bus rides I took between my publishing job in Manhattan and my Latina neighborhood in Jersey, between my Chicana mixed-race girlfriend in the Bronx and my Colombian mother in Jersey. My experience with sexual abuse.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.